much more things that we have to know. Next slide. Zeynep, Fırat, our great neuroradiologist, making great chartography. She presented, and I reflected immediately. I said, hey, this, I like her, this picture. The artist is a Turkish artist, how he sees the brain. There are very interesting compartments, look like it's separated rooms, but they are connected. I had to think about more about it. Next slide. But here is interesting. And here, if we open the window and the modern technology is there, then we may try to understand this way the brain. It is very important for us, for human beings, for entire being, organic and inorganic beings in our world, we should understand the brain more. The brain is not an organ like other organs. This is my message to you. Before I'm leaving this world, there's much more. Next slide. This is my intention today. I found this by Time magazine interesting drawing. The artist put their known and known unknowns. And then there are things we don't like to know it. We negate it. We put also the glasses to improve our view. There's a big philosophy behind it. This is our situation. Even there are knowledgeable things we neglect. We don't like them because we are going not in with our own personal brain. In our brain there are also many other brains. This is why I'm going to tell you. It's not alone individual brain. We have also group brains. Now we have a special group here. This group can be two persons. This can be also now we are 8 billion people. And we have to realize this situation and to understand the sense of this existence and give an interpretation to this. Next. It's much more than this belief. Now, if we put in social scale, we give it 1 meter for human, and in cosmos size, 10 high, 25, and then size of proton, 10 high, minus 15. The astrophysician and the atom physicist, they calculate these type of things. And this 1.5 kilogram heavy brain is another cosmos, is able, after very difficult development, still developing, to calculate, to visualize the galaxies, and also the proton-antiproton collusion. Enormous situation. So this brain is not just an organ like liver or heart and kidney. This is what we have to explain ourselves and to the population. Because there are a lot of very superficial, cheap explanation there in population and in popular papers about how the brain works, etc. They say the brain works only 10%, 20%. Great nonsense is mostly written. Next. We don't know. Next. Now, Feynman was a great atom physicist and he calculated great things. In femtosecond, a quadrillionth of a second, in relation to a second to the second is the incredible numbers. In 1 femtosecond, a molecule is constructed in 60 quadrillionth femtosecond, and it is conceived. Here, something. Ahmed Zewail, Nobel Prize 99, And the Islamic world has a neurotic complex to not be appreciated in there. He's a great man. He made a photos of the molecular movements, shuttle special, shuttle speed. He made a photography with a special camera. For this he got the Nobel Prize. There are entire world great brains, even yourself as a trained or some resident scientist. You have no idea about your brain. You have no idea about your potentials. But you can create more. You can make more. Next slide. So we see what happens within the last 150 years in the astrophysics and biophysics and biology and atom physics. Einstein formulated very well the situation with the energy. And then we had here Hubble extraterrestrial telescope. We see now much more. But in the biology, it's a big step. Francis Crick, James Watson, 1953 declared the structure of the chromosome double helix. And they get the Nobel Prize. But on the background is a Rosalind Franklin. And we have to confess ourselves, we dominate still the females. Most discoveries in the history of research and discovery are females in the background. And same was the Rosalind Franklin. She discovered by X-ray diffraction the structure. And her chief told in a Rome Congress to both gentlemen, and they immediately catched what is the situation. This was the most stimulating information. Now, we have here Martin Cooper. He created cell phone and gave free. And another man, he created our computer system, modern computer system, famously in the English. He gave us a free. He's still alive, he died. And we are trying with the modern technology, improvement in physics and chemistry and biology, to understand the brain and how the modern studies. Still, we don't have a proper method, instrument to come along. The electricity, electromagnetics, and the optogenetics, now is a new breakthrough. But still, there is no method to catch it. Next slide. We came from nanometric now to 30. Picometric and femtometric down. We are now in the cells here, in nanometric and picometric dimensions. And everything runs deep in the micro world. But they discovered genome is good, we build it. Everything will be now well understandable. It is. Still, it's extremely complex to catch it, and then make a scales about this, but it needs much more, bigger computers to use it. It's at the very beginning, first steps. And then we are coming to the problem of the transcription RNA and the ribosomes, the proteome and epigenome and connectomes. It's getting like you open a door, you discover a room full of information, and then there are more doors to get other to other rooms. It's developed further next. Now, our teacher generation was working more in the millimeter dimensions. Microsurgery brought us to much wrong size. We can sit down to 1-2 micron. The structure, the shape better. So we are going down, down, down. And I made this sentence, ultra-microscopic anatomy and ultra-microscopic physiology. Each roots in quantum biology. Once a day, they will found the relation on the ultra structure of the atoms, and then found there some points. But daily life needs other mesoscopic dimension to help our patients. Next. We are here to understand the cell and ultracellular structures, and how this membrane is built up, and how this is working, allowing to communicate about the structure that is biological science, molecular biology is now here. But we are not so far to get for daily program help on this thing. And there is a we realize also from atom physics and astrophysics, both are open edges, the head is open. Genome helix, how it's built up, is open. It's well saved, but it is open because the epigenome shows that modification of DNA, chromatin and histones, and we have now started to have protein surgeons. We enjoy, great. We will eliminate, we saw Dr. Ababa operating internal cream. Now they will start to operate the chromosomes for the genetic group. But now these are coming decades. Now we are not so far. And what the danger is, they will produce also like an atom knowledge, atom reactors, within energy, but also atom bombs. This is a great dangerous waiting now for the biology, for the medicine. Playing with the protein surgery, can you imagine? They can produce also other beings, not human beings, but. Then we have the connectome, the plasticity of the fiber system of, and protein norm. RNA in M and T RNA then at the moment is the biological philosophy play with the ribosome, because the ribosomes are before the cell have been created. It's outside of the cell. Don't only be a moment there. Next slide, please. We got 2014 Nobel Prize. Monoscopy. So we will have an entire change in biology and pathology. We will see the picometric structure in moving. How they change. Excellent. What I understand. And now these are three great men after 30, 40, 50 years fighting and trying. It is difficult laboratory work, how to, the mechanics of the DNA repair, how to kind of get the small segments. It's wonderful. There is one another. We are happy to have a Turkish biologist, Aziz Sandır, he get a Nobel Prize. There is another Turkish neurologist, mathematician. He is working in the United States and working on 7 Tesla, 9 Tesla. And what is the, he may get also Nobel Prize next time, because We saw one pre-Tesla in cryptography, only the myelinized fiber system. With this new development, we will be able to see also the other 50% of the dendrites, etc., visualized. It's coming new world. But this doesn't help us to understand what's going on next time. I may take you back a little. In scientific view, there is a hypothesis, and also the Big Bang, 13.7 billion years, and 4.6 is like our Earth is created. And then atoms in our inorganic molecules, and 4 billion organic molecules, amino acids. There are only 20 amino acids. They are loose, they are left turning, they are open arms. And then prokaryotes, cell membrane created, circular chromosome. Then we see all carotid cell membrane, nucleus, helical double, nucleotides, histone, DNA, RNA. And then here in the all carotid, bacteria was taken in the cell, phagocytosis. And so this is the energy factory in each cell in our body, in all living beings. This is the first symbiogenesis. The oxygen came later, 2 billion years later. And then the animal, the plants also later, they catch the cyanobacteria, the Russian virus. This is the second symbiogenesis. And then it's still not well understood. 580 until this time we have bacteria and protista. But then suddenly we have a 41 philia, entirely new type of living beings. And they have a own way to go. And we are trying to find connections. Yeah, we have all, we use all the same material. Anatomically and physiologically and biochemically. But so the separation, they're also hidden to catch and create a new beings. Maybe we play with the chromosomes. But we came now to this cultural genesis, human brain. And this is the difference from all other beings. This is not well understood. And then, next 200 years coming time, the technogenesis is the fourth symbiogenesis. Next. Everybody asked me whether telephone has a negative effect to the brain in adults or in children, etc. Hexadecimal brain may look once a day this way, but will have an effect. I have no idea, but just occupy my brain, my thoughts, next time. We have to see this interesting scale, 380 million years fish, amphibia, then reptiles, birds, insects, mammals, primates, 5 million. There is some consequential development, but we should not find relation to the primate because there's a big jump here. We are also related to very simple viruses. Next time, they have the same structure, same material. Next time. The situation is also. We may believe we are very important on our Earth, only 10% animals, and we are very small things. Plants also, protected at 30, 10, 50% are the bacteria. and we are living with them another biological cooperation. Without them, it would not exist. Next slide. I'd like to show this slide to you. Just homeobox, few genes create rostral caudal construction on a Drosophila. But same are in the human. And the other one, they disappear. The same material they use, it's small changes. How is it like this? Next slide. Who controlled the development? Now I'm coming to our field. In discussing this special human brain, human, not only brain, but spinal cord and nervous system, with my colleagues in Zurich, with an excellent neurologist, Professor Baumgartner, Günther Baumgartner, a great neurophysiologist. And then later came Valavan, is a young colleague, and he was excellent in his philologic knowledge in old Greek, classical Latin, followed literature, and put this together, put all the work of Jacobs and Shapers and Poelas. We have a primordial brain 500 million years old, this one, pay attention. And this will take almost 1 hour to tell you all the detail. But I jumped 250 million years, Palermo Mayans, first time a red spot there. This is a cortex layer, five layers. Here are not so layers, they are much more diffuse than other. This is the insula. Insula is the first cortical area. From there is constructed later on the small area. You see how these cortex arise and come along. So to make it short, our brain, the central nervous system, has a history in part of the brain, not only 5 million parts are, say, spinal cord and brainstem, 500 million year old structure. But neopalu is just few millions. Next slide. So therefore, we have to pay attention. Human brain is a multidimensional and multifunctional in biological, psychological, social, and metaphysical aspects. Well, functions or the dysfunctions is the main problem. We are happy we can control many dysfunctional drives in our brains. Control ourselves, our societies. Next. Now, I give you a message to you. In contrast to every other organs, the brain has a history. Liver, kidney, heart, they are since million years the same. Same. The biggest size of the body. This history is the co-evolutionary philo, onto, and sociogenesis. Here I added sociogenesis, it irritates many colleagues also. Well, inform people. I will come along this. The human brain has the brain developed through hundreds of million years of a co-evolution specific structural regions and developed distinct functional circuits. We develop language, we develop mathematics, we develop art, each time, sciences, philosophy, religion, and I can share more. Each topos in the brain is linked to the chronos, so the areas and functions of the brain is directly related to a certain chronological end, worldview. Lieutenant Terry of Development. So, I appreciate very much the work of the molecular biologists, they go down to the femtometric world, but we are forgetting the time period, time scale, where we came from, and what is special with this human being. And I don't declare brain is a holy organ because we can be also a devil type of actions. Next slide. Here. Language developed now, that much we have now electronic language. You have in your hands, in your pocket, you found images of all libraries and connections. And then technology developed, and mathematics developed from counting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then now I operated a gentleman professor from Technical High School. He was a mathematics professor and calculating by 10, 11 dimensions. He had a frontal glioblastoma. He removed it, and then 3, 4 days later, I visited him unexpectedly, entered his room, and I saw 4 or 5 people. They came across the street to our hospital, and they had been discussing with him. They stuck on a problem they didn't know how to solve. And this fresh operated man, with his brain, was looking, I was witness. He said, here, you made it wrong. And explained them how to go further. He said, brain is a unique organ. Also in mathematics, art is high developed. Mathematics is now in the 10, 11 dimensions. And we have difficulties to understand fourth dimension, or fifth dimension, to understand even Einstein. Art is now X arms. Birds also singing, they are building also some houses, etc. But it is, until this has been developed, it took how many times, this room, this electricity, everything. Science has at the moment several hundred subspecialties. It is all the same, religion the same. But what is unique in human being also is the competition. We like to have a physical and mental, psychological and mental competition to do better. The animals tend to, they don't do it. They fight each other in certain time periods, but they don't came to the idea to throw a stone further. Or a piece of a stick, or jump higher. But we train them to run the dogs or the horses. But they don't have these abilities. Also, the so-called chimpanzees near to our development, they don't have these abilities. No competition. Many great abilities. Each filial has their own line. And we have to have the great respect for this. Each group, each one tries to survive, but we try to make it better life. It is difficult. At the moment also we are fighting there and there, terrible stories, but the human being in the long line show great development. Mainly is that we fear to be death, to die. Because that's understandable. Great hard work to develop a brain and suddenly you are gone. What will remain? But the point maybe is explained this way, is better we go because new young generation should come and take over. So the genetic is very important, but also mimetic is important. Yeah. The sociogenesis, this means we learn the language from mother, also mimic, gestic, and all traditions we learn. Each culture has its own stand up, or even the sitting and lying, and also walk. We can tell how different people, Asiatic or European or American, they stay on their walk. We learn, we copy everything. Interesting is how our walk gets global. I see on TV, in 5 continents, everybody, all men have no birth. The new mode is to have a birth. The short-cut hair and birth. Everybody, everybody. And that's it. We are copying, we are interpreting. These are originally, these are, they have been separated. Language, they saw two elephants, or they say two, a lot. We are still using our manual language. We should realize this, the brain has not only biogenesis, also sociogenesis. The sociogenesis is given us through the culture where we live. And there are documents. Culture disappears, but they are continuing somewhere after a while. Thanks. Up to now, it did disappear completely. Look into the brain from biological view, we have a parenchymal organ, vascular organ, sensory organ, circumventricular organ. This is not well known, not respected, because we cannot control. Yesterday, Dr. Ture was near locus ceruleus area and playing there. The endocrine organ, neuroendocrine, etc., etc. They are all interconnected. And the most important part is also scalp and cranium and meninges. Many things happen here. The peripheral nerve and mental activities. If we get the information, not genetically, I'm not informed about genetical transfer of certain knowledge and abilities of mental capacities, but this tradition at home, at schools, in at universities, in the training centers, we are learning, and then the mental abilities can control other centers, direct, indirectly. It's an enormous interwoven actions. Next, this is my view. As I came to neurosurgery 1953, it was this concept. We have two cerebral hemispheres, two cerebellar hemispheres, and the brainstem. And we have been happy to know the symptoms related maybe the frontal, or parietal area, occipital area, or cerebellar. There was at least in 10% great difficulties to separate from frontal, and cerebellar disbalance and nystagmus could occur. And we had an electroencephalography in our hands, and then we had an angiography, next step. Nowadays, the patient go to CT and MRI within half an hour. Information is there, but more rough speak for many problems of the brain, especially headaches, dizziness. 90% of people, we don't say anything. We say normal brain. Okay, now, but if we look at the brain, we can say this is the frontal, this is the political area, and we separate here for the artificially here in the central sulcus. This is the frontal, this is the parietal. This is hypothesis, this is all dogma. In biology, in pathology, this doesn't exist. We don't have a frontal, temporal, parietal, but it's good we are using as a communicative system. We say, after, look, if you make the cortex, show me the clear line between temporal and occipital, frontal, and I call this area central, precentral, postcentral, and there's a very close relation from here to here, and also from here to here inside. And also here, when it talks about that we like to create such a line somewhere. We can say from here to here is the occipital. It's much complex. Next. To make it easy, in phylogenetic view, we see no parallel area. Six layer cortex. It is a new area. Frontal, precentral, postcentral, parietal, occipital, temporal. And then we have this yellow, the limbic area, cingulate, and medial temporal, not here frontal, orbital, posterior, and then these ones are connected. And then we have the stem area. Each one has their own arterial and venous vascularization. And variation on this, each one different. Next. We see if you talk, I cannot talk.
That's outside.
It's outside? So, this is the danger. You can say cerebral area, and then here the encephalon, mesencephalon, and metencephalon is interesting. Go back again, sorry. Yeah, neopallial, easy. A tumor in the neopallial area, I say, here in this segment, and also here. But here, but this tumor doesn't infiltrate the archaeal and paleopallial and basal ganglia and the brainstem. If something occurs here in thalamus, it doesn't go up here. So, great German anatomist and great pathologist gave the idea of infiltration. But I am opposing not only for the brain, for entire organs, there is no infiltration. Even the eye and ear and everywhere in our body, and the liver and heart, everywhere there are compartments. And the disease is different. Diseases occur in one compartment, remain there and expansive. They got larger. I can tell this because I saw at least 10,000 cases I operated, vascular and tumoral nerve. Plastic, infections. There are compartments. I will show you this next. Also, if we have a lesion in thalamus, it doesn't infiltrate the hypothalamus. Even the hypothalamic area is one side, is very rarely more bilateral, very rarely bilateral thalamus. Also, this doesn't expand down to mesencephalon. Mesencephalon remain here, and also metencephalon continue area remain here. And this remain here, on cerebellum, same. Compartment, compartment, like some trouble arises in this room, but next room is shape, is a wall. Next slide. Even in the mesencephalon, we have a dorsal area, dorsal lateral, lateral, and ventrolateral, and central area. The lesion, diseases arise in certain compartments. Next. We can still use the old terminology, call it frontal, only the frontal, superior, middle, and inferior, they have very certain variation. It was generally said this is why. Chaotic is not. There is a special order. And precentral also, this is very rare, this shape. You will see next book. We studied this on some 500 examples, and it is interesting. There is certain rule, same temporal area, but there is a not border right there. But this beige color, this is the limbic system, and the neuroanatomists realized this 160, 70 years ago. There is something different here. If we have a disease, even there are compartments, either here, 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 here. If the disease developed negatively, if the patient survived, we operate here, we see later occurs here or here, but not here, not here. In my knowledge, we don't have any tumor arising in the area 17-18 in the occipital. No tumor. And also no tumor in the lingual gyrus. Why? We don't know. And this part was completely forgotten, the insula, and we discovered by surgery. We realized there are tumors localized either here or entire system, but doesn't go to other parts. Stay here. And AVMs, cavernomas, just here. Because the insula was forgotten for decades, and also physiologically extremely difficult to make an experiment to understand the function. Next, I will come back. Here again, inside, this is archimyopodial cingulate. This is subcausal area, and this is the cingulate and preconius and down, isthmus, and then parahippocampus and humerus, and temporal pole somewhere involved. Lateral view, this is now newly discovered area, and can be cornered. A tumor never infiltrate here, never. It looked like, but never. Was a lesion rarely here, doesn't go to this place. Yeah. Everything occurs in the phylogenetic compartments. Next slide. We discussed with the neurologist, Professor Balamanis, and they showed us there is the measurement of phylogenetic different cortical regions. You see, medial temporal, amygdala hippocampus, parahippocampus, cingulate, the insula, and cingulate area. They are different. So we can separate them. Next slide. There are much precise measurements. If a lesion occurs in this area, it was thought it goes infiltrated along the fiber system. Yesterday, Dr. Kramer showed it is not the case. We taught him this is not the case. But why it's going down to the ventricle? Because from the periventricular matrix, billions of cells, neuronal and glial cells, migrate to these places, and they have the code to go there, genetic code. And they come, they know maybe the tumor cell, they have a tendency to come back. Also the angiogenesis, at the same time period, developing with the nerve cells, they respect, and they go also to the AVM from down to this area. Next slide. Neuropineal tumor, there are certain places. And here, one from the one, the temple area. And this is the Pareto area, next slide. ABM, they are also in certain areas, not everywhere. You may have a neocortical, and and here it looks a diffuse. No, it's a cingulate area, this is the insular area, this is the medial temporal area. If we know this compartment, it's the vascular compartment, we can operate. The regions of the brain and the spinal cord, vascular or AVM, cavernomas, and the tumors, almost 99% can be nowadays precisely operated. This is the contribution of micro neurosurgery. If we respect the systemal system and reach the corner, you saw yesterday the work of Turek presented. Next. I show you one thing. This gentleman had a bleeding, right side, medial was a temporal, from the low scene. Here is the posterior cerebral artery. The lesion sits in the amygdala parahippocampus. Now, there's a discussion whether it should be radiated. Gamma knife is now big, molded, but doesn't help that much. They say only small one or 2-3 sessions, nonsense. Embolization helps in 40% to eliminate completely. Bonavanis has some 2,000 cases experience. It is a great endovascular surgeon. They cannot eliminate in every case, but in microsurgery, we are able to eliminate in 85%. It's a big development. And the population is irritated by internet saying it's very dangerous, etc. Next slide. Here, you see this lesion in the temporal area, and you realize something, it's not paid enough attention. We pay attention to the bleeding or the seizure, but you see here, this is a galenic vein around this corpus callosum, splenium, and then very wild enlargement, and here is stop. Here is this oval larynx. The straight sinus is some way stenotic, because the enormous flow is here per minute. Maybe 500 cubic cc may run here, and then endothel cannot stay this. Next. Operated and removed. And by operation, we remove also the hematoma and hemosiderin. The brain cells doesn't like hemosiderin. Trouble them to make their seizures. Next slide. Again, I show you the tumors that are here in the frontal area, and here in the insular area, in the archipallial, in the medial, and here paleopallial, posterior front orbital septal area, and subpallial. Next slide. I showed some cases. Where is this tumor? Huge tumor. It looks like an entire hemisphere. And this involves not the insula. The insula is here, it's behind the insula. It is in the Hessian gyrus. These are transverse temporal gyri, two entered down to the inferior periphery sulcus. This lady is right-handed, and she's stewardess, and speaks 7 languages. By seizure, she is in trouble. for the ultimate chest storage. And it was recommended biopsy and radiation, etc. I described, I said, we cannot make sure every surgery, even the birth is the most natural action in life, isn't 0.1% complication. We may have, we don't know in individual resistance. She accepted surgery, we could remove it. You see, you can see better where we had to remove her personality, her intelligence, memory remain intact. It's like, even if these are in trouble before surgery, they recover mostly. Here is a young student, I remember in Zurich, you see the tumor attendance from cortex down to the ventricle, where the cell went up here, and back, and removed. Precise removal under microscope, we get ability to recognize where is normal tissue, where is pathological tissue. Okay. Again, we show neopile system frontal, insular. In the archipelagal area, it is a cingulate area. In the parapelagal, it is a septal area there. And the subpelagal in the lentiform nuclei. Next slide. Now, great research occurred in small department in psychiatry by Professor Chambers. Very simple microscope. But still, he made an excellent cytoarchitecture of the brain. He's somewhere forgotten. He published 1904. And the time was right. It makes same time, it makes. In Germany, Brodmann, he found some 53 areas. It's interesting. We measure this circle area different. We give numbers. Next. Economos and Potskina's two Greek colleagues, they made a great work in Vienna, Austria. Brodmann worked only one brain. They worked on three brains, they got more millimeter-wise, but they came more or less same result, separated certain area by cytoarchitecture. And you see, this part is different, this part is different. I will show you also, there are some more parts here by my gyro studies. And even if we pay attention, parietal area, we have a superior part, an inferior part, and the medial part. And also occipital, superior, medial, and inferior part. Next. Okay. This is a new breakthrough. The hierarchical genetic organization of human cortical system areas. Chinese now coming up in the United States. They discovered the same map, genetic of the disease, you see, cingulate and precluneus, there are areas genetically fixed. In our, related to our experience, we separate this limbic system, so called this girdle system, with cingulate and hippocampus, parahippocampus, and temporal fold. There are several compartments. The region arises here, only here, only here, only here, or here, remain here. By recurrence, again here. And then we have insula. Insula is between neocortical, neopaleal, and then paleopaleal system. And there are some 10, 15 compartments around this area. Next. The young girl having a seizure. Now, General, we know seizures is a sensomotoric or Jacksonian, and then, but neurovegetative, this is mostly feeling bad or feeling some trouble in stomach pain, heartburn, say the American, some bad smell in mouth or nose, that all neurovegetative seizures. Here's the lesion, maybe it was our temporal. And here's the left side, we have to enter here, but without removing the normal area, this abnormal. We should never do transcerebral exploration. Selective lesionectomy, here after removal, you see, this is before I entered here, this is the M1, and two branches, and then after removal of the tumor, we see here the posterior cerebral tissue and anterior cortical, and here's the pedunculus cerebri. This is everything intact. Next. Without microtechnology, it's not possible. This is after surgery. It looks intact in arachnoid membrane, it grows again. It is removed, selective removal. Respect for normal brain. Next slide. Here, another case. After removal. This is amygdala hippocampus, parahippocampus. These areas are normal. We should never go transcerebral. Never. There are billions of cells. Next. Remove only tumor. Here, another case. Huge tumor, right side, temporal, and they describe it as a temporal parietal occipital tumor and infiltrating the brainstem. And this lady came from Sicily with a family, some 10, 15 members. And how was her condition? She was in a good condition, walked in the room, and she was the only person speaking much better English than me. And was studying at the time in Napoli, Neapoli. I discussed with her, and she was very bright, and she said, okay. She was recommended to make biopsy and radiation inoperable tumor. I said, nine, we will do this, and we will save your, eventually your result field if we stay in tumor. If the tumor is that much large, it's like a burst channel is open, we came from here. And then Eric Gordon removed this tumor completely. And she did a lawyer, doing very well. And it's a low grade lesion. And I have patients still alive after, before even microsurgery, I have patients still alive 57 years. Till I'm a surgeon. So there's some defatistic attitude to say, oh, glioma.
Yeah, compartmental.
We do proper surgery, we can help. Next. Here, this is a unit. Yesterday, we discussed. This lady was working on a factory, make a special work in a serial. Troubled by seizure, she stopped to work. And the supervisor discovered she's troubling the whole group. And they made a consultation by a neurologist and finally MRI. You see here, left side of the tumor from temporal pole, amygdala, parahippocampus, and part of tumor on dorsal mesencephalon. I said, how I can go? I can come down here, but we cannot turn around. It's a microscope. And I decided to operate her from in sitting position, supracerebellar transsectorial, operated 2001. Next slide. Here. Should be made in 15 years on a plastic astro oligo. Still alive, still active. She's not so active as before maybe, but she likes play music and go to hunting, etc. She has her pleasures and always corresponding with Mrs. Yasargil. You're a pleasant person. Next slide. Negative attitude. Another case. You see here? The lesion. She had just seizures. This is the posterior cingulate in part of the precuneus and part of the posterior parietal gum, which is the area. And she was told biopsy, radiation. She's a well-known great artist in New Orleans. And she was at that time in the age of 30s. And we operated in 1997, 98, 10,
yeah?
Yeah. In Little Rock. It is also an anaplastic oligo. And she's still alive and she make every year exhibitions from her art, modern art. So I don't understand attitude of a neurologist, neuropathologist, or also neurosurgeon saying degrading is something for me is not enough to understand what's going on. And the neuropathologist, they made every 10 year a new scale. And, but this is not my problem, it's not only this microscopic world, because there's something more. She's doing very well. Right? And she has normal visual field. Here, another Brazilian patient, you know, young girl had seizures, and the picture had been sent to me. My first reaction was, oh, well, this is beyond my abilities, inoperable. We cannot do it. And then I'd like to see her picture. Okay, but I paid attention. How come this tumor arises here and irritates it? Callosum. That's something different. The tumor came out from midline, internal to the fistula. Came like a placenta over the brain. Next slide. Here, after surgery, the tumor came from here around. You see, this was some 3-4 days after surgery. Very bright, heavy girl. Came from here. The MRI is, we appreciate very much. It's great, great help, but still the electronic calculation is not reality. It overlaps and over-exaggerates, saying this is diffuse, ta-ta-ta-ta, but the reality is a little different. The condition of the patient, she came to from Rio to Little Rock, she was very alert and very bright girl. Next slide. And then, some 10 years later, we went to a meeting in Iguazu, and we met them there to where they were meet. And then here, the tumor just in the septal area, very separate area, it goes in seizures, not in the hypothalamus. It approach transcranial, transforamina down. Not from below. From below, I could go up here. You cannot see. Pternum. I have to come down. Next. Another case. It looks like a temporal tumor. Mediobasal, but it is not. Mediobasal part is intact. The lesion is in the fusiform gyrus. You see here. After removal, you see, mediobasal intact, and the neopalatal is also intact. That's fusiform gyrus. Next slide. Again, 10 years later, we went to the meeting in Brazil, we met her in the airport. And Rio airport is somewhere big and very active, you can get irritated. And she helped there very much, Diana. We have been lost by the noise and activities of people. Next slide. I saw four this type patients. This was the daughter of an American pilot in Australia. She was troubled by behavior at school. In the age of some 7 or 8, she started to attack the other children. And the teacher said to the parents, "You cannot accept this. Other children are irritated." And then she had a slight right, left side pain syndrome. This is not mediobasal temporal, is also not optic glioma. This is a mammillary body glioma. Four cases. All four, they showed psychological aggressiveness. In all other tumors that I saw, preoperative, postoperative, several thousand, my own cases and all other colleagues, and my professor Granger, I never saw any criminal person among these glioma patients or alien patients. They can be irritated. Even in the history of Dr. Granger, his father was a psychiatrist, and he insisted his son should get a psychiatrist and sent him to a famous center in Berlin. And then the patient died, was diagnosed as schizophrenic. And by autopsy, they found a large olfactory meningioma. In case of olfactory meningioma, the frontal orbital area are under the pressure. They are neglecting themselves and their household and their work. They are different. But I never saw any criminal people. She made a good recovery. And the other, Ture has also the same experience with 3 or 4 cases. They show some uncontrolled behavior. Next slide. This is an indolent tumor, again to show in this picture made by Mr. Roth, how compressed the volumetrous claustrum, the tumor polydom. Tumor expansive, never infiltrates. Next slide. You see, in view of the neuropathologist, it's infiltrative. No. Here we have the lentiformiferous compressed media. This is swollen tumor. This is from collection of Professor Kleibel's neuropathologist in Zurich. Next. And here, this child has a tumor here, posterior part of the insula, well diagnosed on MRI, and after removal. Only this island, small part. Next. It, they look all the same. You see, this was a chief secretary speaking several languages in Zurich, and he developed some seizures and came to us after MRI made. And we discussed 2-3 times with her what should be done. She was intact, still working, and only had seizures, more vegetative type. I couldn't promise her whether she will not have any syndrome postoperative. After long thinking and some more seizures, she decided yes. But pay attention. I operated pure insula, 104 that I own. In 12 AM in some sense number of a moment. They look all the same. They never go in to other structure. You see it? Stop here. Either the tumors are going to be to enter to this area or the defense line doesn't allow. If we take here generously, maybe we destroy also the defense system. Next. This was well removed completely. And I have been asked several times on meetings how I did know the borderline, where I did decide to stop. Now, honestly, I'm telling you, I tried to do my best. I realized there are tumors, but mostly is my knowledge in neuroanatomy. I worked also like Dr. Thierry, and I assisted also Thierry with Dr. Niklaus. Go laboratory, then you are at home with anatomy. And then in my brain there are 100 billion neurons they say, and then 1,000 billion glial cells. We have several hundred type of neurons, very specialists. Maybe there are a group of neurons they told me beyond my knowledge, what I should do. So I'm not joking, if I tell I didn't know how I made it, you got the same too. We do, by some experience, knowledge combined, we are happy, well done. Next. And here, you see here this large tumor. It looks terrible, it looks infiltrating to other side. Wrong. It's not infiltrating. There is a PIA, arachnoid PIA, four lines. It's expansive under the fault. And how is the condition of this lady? She came with her husband from Germany to Little Rock. She did like the radiation, she did like the biopsy. And we discussed also 2, 3, 4 times. They have been standing 1 week or more in hotel. I said, we have to do this, but she was told, here, M1 and the perforator, by removal, she will be hemiplegic, possibly. I said, on the opposite. I said, we cannot tell sure, but we can not get information about the relation of the tumor cells to the vessel surface. There are some tumors stick on the vessel artery wall, the vein wall, or dissectable. On her case was possible. Next. This lady, she survived. She said, I like to be operated and survive. She had a small child. I like to see my girl growing. I would like to help. I'm a mother. This is a special wish. As a man, we don't understand maybe very well, but she's a very intelligent person. But this large tumor, she was intact, intellectual and in memory, and very intact. And she was writing nice letters to Mrs. Stein, and several times, every Christmas time. I think she survived 12 to 13 years. Also anaplastic polygon. Next. Here, as I came first time to Little Rock 1994, I got this young man, Italian. His father was a professor at Rome for agriculture. And he opened for his son in Boston a shop. Transport fresh fruit and everything, and he was a successful businessman. We discussed him, he had seizures, we discussed and we operated. But this was a little difficult time for me to foreign atmosphere to operate. And I didn't succeeded to remove completely. And I said to him next day, hey, his nickname was Robert. Robert, we have to operate again. He said, no, I'm going home. And he went home. And he didn't come back. Next slide. And then this happened some long time, 10 years or more. You see, the tumor grow again the same place. Doesn't infiltrate wild everywhere. They cannot infiltrate. And this was also great. 2.5 and 3, later again 3. And then we operated them. Okay, next slide. This, I don't like to tell them. This case is much impressive. Actually, I should show only this to you, what it means. This is a gentleman from Istanbul, and he is a businessman, and in his, he was building a hotel in a beautiful corner in Istanbul, in the seashore. And on a discussion on a table, he felt himself not well. He stand up, walk around, look irritated around, and then came back and sit down. And the other people told him, hey, what was this? You should go to doctor. He went to doctor and discovered. And finally MRI was made. And this lesion, look here. It is in the system. In the hippocampus, parahippocampus is part of the insula and the posterior from the orbital and septal area. I told him, I wrote him, he should come over. And he called, and at that time I was in Zurich. He cannot come, he has to finish his hotel. He didn't come. 2003, I came to visit in Turkey, in Ankara. He came with this picture. You see, the tumor grow local expansive. Get bigger, and also the deformed nerves are still intact, compressed. And this is like colistin now, we operate. Yeah. Again, on a plastic olive. Our attitude is anaplastic olive is almost glioblastoma, yeah? Next. 2003. We saw him 2 weeks or 4 weeks ago. This is our last picture. This is picture from 2003. He has some recurrent here. Next, what is that? It disappeared. We didn't give him any radiation, nothing, just chemotherapy. He's mentally intact, very intelligent man, and clear, and he got a little too much testosterone, and did the round, technological intact and mentally intact, doing well. Imagine, how much year? 1991, long living, next year. Also the attitude, the mediovascular temporal area are very important for memory. And we know it is important, it's essential for vegetative seizures, but in my experience with the temporal epilepsy cases, removal of amygdala-hippocampectomy, we saw contrary improvement of the memory. 220 patients, the tumor the same. And I said I operated 104 pure insula. I operated 170 this time, multi-compartment. And the people are still intact. Now watch this picture very well. we would say, how is the condition of this lady? They're operated here, temporal area, and their seizures are stopped. But he's, he'd like to go in. Yeah, but as you know, from the medical literature, Kluver-Bucy syndrome, these people are after bilateral lesions or operations, irritated, they have negative behavior, etc., etc., bad memory. What do you think? How she is? I do a little theatrical because enough theater around us. Next slide. But I made it here. But this is another view. Next. Here. She's a, I think, 46 or the same year old lady. Live in Istanbul alone, doesn't drive a car, and has an excellent memory, and go to shopping. And she has two adult daughters. She's separated now. Go back again. You see, if we have this area, multi-compartmental, even medial temporal and insular, some seizure patients with a hippocampal sclerosis. Main symptom is we think we are somewhere wrong involved in our mental development. We are not asking the people the sexual life. Is a war still between patient and doctor? We don't put the question. But I found many patients, young, happy families, etc., children, small children, divorced. And I asked, what was wrong? And they said, oh, my husband or patient or that lady patient didn't have any more sexual interest. So we had to separate, divorce. Same is here. So this is already discussed in a paper from Earl Walker. He was chairman in Johns Hopkins and famous neurosurgeon in the 1950s. In one paper, he says the seizure patient, they operated lobectomy type. By temporal seizures, they have this sexual problem. We should be awake about this fact. He's separated. Next slide. What we know. One another case. This happened around 1973. 57-year-old patient came to neurology, and Professor Baumgartner came in the evening around 7 o'clock in the afternoon. Said, I have this patient. I don't know whether you would like to operate. A tumor in the right thalamus. It looked like a malina. I said, oh, but she has Hemi syndrome. She was a chief of a band. Very high level in the airport. And then I said, okay, we should give radiation. I'm usually against it. Maybe I was tired, I don't know what was wrong. I didn't like to operate. Half an hour later, I was in my room, knocked on the door. A man came in and said, are you the professor? I said, yes, sir. I congratulate you. You're a Turk, Turkish origin. You get such a position in Europe, in Zurich, as the chairman of neurosurgery. But I tell you, you are not a god. You're a professor. You reject to operate my wife. How you know this? You cannot operate. I called Diane.
I said, prepare tomorrow. Saturday we operated her. Turned out to be glioblastoma.
And this slides have been sent to Germany and to United States. They confirmed it's glioblastoma. It's possible. She survived beautifully and everything went very well. And she returned to her position. Now tell me how long she survived. 14 years. And she died of kidney carcinoma. It's different. So I'm very, as told you, the elder you get, the more you are irritated. But we know in the biology, it's everything is a hypothesis. Experience is important, respect is important. Next slide. This was a young man, 1975, he came from Bern, from Project Huber. He sent to me. He said, he made an angiography and there is a tumor on temporal occipital area. I can tell. I don't have the picture. This may be the fusiform gyrus. I removed. He made a good recovery. And was doing very well. 25 years. No glioblastoma. And then he came 2000 to Zurich department. Another surgeon in Switzerland. On MRI, they found this lesion here, hyperintensity. They thought this may be some infiltrative. They made biopsy, it was a normal filamentous tissue. He had a radiation, so this made a radiation effect, this disease. But they found, next slide. This lesion, infratentorial, in histology was not glioblastoma, turned out to be pinnate, primitive thoracodermal tumor. They operated and this, he made a good recovery, but he didn't survive long. His case is published in literature. Next slide. So, 1985-86 MRI was available. And everybody enjoyed. In the department of Dr. Andrew, 1936 to 86, 50 years, we had 6 cases of cavernoma. 6 hematoma removed and cavernoma histologically found. And then from 1986 to 1993, in this few years, I had almost 100 patients cavernoma, which was explosive. In the world now, where the most frequent lesion is cavernoma. If there is a lesion in blood, we have to do. If there's a symptom, we have to do. And if there are no symptoms, it's asymptomatic, we have to wait. But why are we waiting? I operated again around 230 cases and published in the warning 3B and 4B, these cases. And I showed we can operate everywhere and it's not difficult. The best result we can cut it there. But now, we see every week some 60 patients. At least 5 had a cavernoma. Some had a blood. We recommend surgery. They are very reluctant. They fear surgery. And the people have been told you may die, you may get injured, hemiplegic, aphasic. And then they go to Kamenei. Although Dr. Steiner was very critical, great pioneer in Kamenei therapy, He said, don't do this. But it's now given. But the problem is make much difficult because Government Act doesn't help anything to this small or large carcinoma. It has a negative effect to normal tissue. But we cannot help this now. In internet, people are more informed about neuropathology than I am. Why I'm showing this to you? What do you think? This gentleman has a multiple lesions. This is very rare. I saw him last time, five, six years ago in Little Rock. He came every 2-3 years to see me. What you should operate? He has no bleeding, no seizure. He's a professor of theology and philosophy. He came to talk to me because we had a nice discussion. What do? You see? How precise we know. Our advances are great in the modern technology, diagnostic technology. But what we don't know, when an AVM will bleed, how fast the tumor will grow, is guessing. The medicine and surgery is still at least 50% guessing. Daily action, mostly we don't know. We have no idea about headaches and dizziness, and even no medication for coughing. We did something. Hey. The next slide. I don't know anything. Cecil Vogt, Oscar Vogt are great neuroscientists. Cecil Vogt is from French, and Oscar Vogt is North Germany. They met each other in Paris and learned their modern neurology. And then worked together in Germany some 60-70 years. He started?
Yes,
And they made a great work in architecture, chief architecture, in neuroanatomy and neuropathology. Many terms are created by these two people, what we know. Neopallium, archipallium, paleopallium, and then all this. And then they said the term pathocrisis. This means the selective vulnerability of specific neuronal population in the CNS related to somacrisis and gene crisis. Okay. This is 1900, 115 years ago, they get this idea, gene crisis or soma, cell. Next. Selective vulnerability of different compartments of cells, phylogenetic, genetic, immune, and all different diseases can occur. If our body has many compartments, well safe, if there's a selective vulnerability. Next. And they wrote a letter to Paul Ehrlich. He got Nobel Prize 1998 for his work on the syphilis therapy. And he said, they said, what should we do for this selective diseases? He said, drew folks' attention to the fact that various brain cells and diverse areas of the brain may have developed different receptors, and this in turn may be related to genetics. It may therefore be an assignment called neuropharmacology to develop super selective agents, each of which is designed to confine its effect to one specific brain area. This is now our stage in the neurodiagnosis and neurotherapy. So we have to develop individual medication. And then individual related to the what the pathology should give us information. So we are at this point in the last next. I said at the beginning, no knowns, known unknowns. We know that we don't know. The body, we know partially. So we speculate a lot and split. Great, some knowledges are there. But we, in German, just Geist, they separate. In terms of, say, Bühne, condition, maybe. We don't know the condition of these people. If I have a patient in my front, I may, from my experience, say, this person will stay the surgery. 3 hours, 10 hours, but can stay. It is just guessing, not clear. But the point is, I'm coming to end. We have, in philosophical term, honor and dignity. In Turkish language, we translate both terms, onur, onur, also in philosophy. Actually, the dignity is a very deep term for the very, very original. I mean, what we understand, how a proton and call electron, and we make now atom. This is the beginning. Micro, space and time and action start. And the human being destroyed the dignity of atom world. We made the atom bombs. Now we are on the way even to destroy dignity of the in the biology. We start to play with this. In Turkish, we should tell for dignity, haysiyet. It is the Arabic word, hasa. This means also very original term of place and time and action. Hasasa. I read this way. But if this, the original, the earth, can you tell me? What I like to say is, we should, by our action, not only honor the patients and their personality, also think on the, I said, to dignity, but not only the person, also the tissue, also a cell. And to my good colleagues, by my operation, I have a great respect for dignity of aneurysm, or AVM, or tumor cell. I don't like to attack the tumor cell aggressively, hey, to hell with you. Be nice with the tumor, not aggressively. Remove the tumor cell also with respecting the dignity, because we don't have the telos sense of this pathological, so tumor cell, but what's, why they are there. We have just loving, helping to eliminate them. This is my personal, professional philosophy and view. Thank you very much. Later, now say, so we like to go surgery. Which one is the paper?